Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel. My name is Jalen, and today I'm going over all of the books that I read in the month of July. And I read a good number of books, but I will say it's mostly because they're quite short, but I will say I read a lot of really good stuff this month, so I'm excited to get into it. But before I do, I wanted to ask, what is the best book that you've read in the month of July? What's your least favorite? Let me know how your reading month's going. How's your reading year going? I would love to hear about it. I'll just hop into the first book that I read this month, and it is Gag Reflex by L. Nash. And L. Nash is an author that I saw in conversation with Melissa Broder and Brontez Purnell, and they were talking about sex writing for this event. I love Brontez Purnell and Melissa Broder, so I wanted to check out L. Nash and see what her work is all about. And this is her new novel published by Clash Books, which is an imprint that I really enjoy. They tend to publish a lot of like transgressive and like horror adjacent books, I want to say. And I really like finding that in terms of indie presses and reading more horror adjacent things. I tend to really like things that are dark and depraved, which is a trend on my channel. But this one is, as I mentioned, her latest, and this is a book set entirely in 2005 on a live journal from a high school senior. And so Lucy is documenting her battle with an eating disorder throughout this entire book. I think this book is a really engaging and harrowing story about a girl who is trying to grapple with herself and what she's doing to herself and trying to find community online through live journal and documenting this idea of herself on the internet. Myself, I did not have a live journal growing up, but I was on like Tumblr and MySpace and all of that. And just thinking about the sort of confessional aspects that can kind of come from being online and trying to find community that way and sort of opening up in the most vulnerable way possible through having like an open forum on the internet is something really interesting in terms of this being sort of like an epistolary diary style novel, but placing it on the internet was really engaging for me to see how L. Nash kind of moves through like the auto fiction of it all, and also thinking about how when you find community when you're going through something traumatic such as this, and thinking about how even though those people aren't necessarily the most healthy or foster the most healthy habits for yourself, what the sense of online community can really mean for recovery and for finding yourself and being able to express your deepest, darkest thoughts. I really enjoyed that aspect of this novel. While this book is incredibly, incredibly tough to get through at times in terms of it being very explicit in its content, I think it is necessarily so. And it's one of the most engaging books that I've read in quite a while and one of the most interesting in terms of its form, being set entirely on the internet. And in the author's note following the book, she talks about how she found community. This is an autofictional book, as I mentioned. But I really liked what she said here. So she says, "I dislike when people discount the lives of teenagers as dull and that everything is dramatic, because we all lived through some traumatic shit and we're dealing with it the best we could. We were living through abandonment and abuse and addiction completely on our own with only our fucked up sense of rules to guide us." I think it's really interesting in terms of, I feel like a lot of people are quite dismissive of even like YA novels or books that sort of look at child narrators or teenagers and sort of thinking about the literary merit of those. And I think this book is really exploring how L. Nash in the present sense is sort of reflecting on how she processed that trauma growing up. It was just incredibly powerful and so a book that I constantly think about. And it was really different. I'm really excited to read more L. Nash. I think she's really exciting. And I think she's going to be a writer that's going to be for me through her other books as well. So that was Gag Reflex. Next up, I have a disturbing, incredibly disturbing book. It is Tampa by Alyssa Nutting. And when I tell you this book is wild, I don't say that lightly. This book is wild. It follows a 26-year-old woman who is a middle school teacher married to a cop, and she is a pedophile. And so this book is told in the first person, so you're very much in the head of Celeste as she thinks through her inner desires, how she starts to formulate a plan to prey on 14-year-old boys. And the novel essentially follows her preying on one boy named Jack and how that all plays out for her. And so this book makes the reader deeply uncomfortable because you have to sit with Celeste's inner thoughts. But I think what Alyssa Nutting is doing in this book that is really interesting and works really well is that she's looking at this idea of female beauty and placing us in the mind of a woman who is young, wouldn't really be expected by societal standards to be a pedophile, and what is she able to get away with given those expectations placed on her in this community. So while this book is very disturbing, it's sort of like a train wreck, how you can't really look away from it, but you feel immensely gross while reading it. But I think she's doing it effectively through this novel to place you in the head of Celeste and make the reader deeply uncomfortable by being in the head of a narrator that you don't really want to be in, but you also can't look away from what's happening in the book. You want to see, where is she going to get away with this? Is she going to be brought to justice? And what does that look like by the end of the novel? So overall, this one was probably the most plotty book that I read this month, but I think it is really successful, especially if you like books in the style of like Otessa Moshfegh or Melissa Broder, that's very pacey and very much a character study that explores the depravity of humanity. I think this is a book that might be for you, but it's hard to recommend this book just like blanket because it is so vile in so many aspects, but I do think it's smart and worth the read. But yeah, it seems to be quite well read and it's fairly popular, but yeah, it's wild. Giving you a warning here. That's that one. Next up, I read a short story collection called Gods of Want by Kaiming Chang, and really exciting because I actually got to interview Kaiming Chang about this book, and you can watch that now. I'll link it below. It's also on podcast platforms if you prefer to listen, but it was a really awesome conversation. She is incredibly kind, but this short story collection was really interesting and sort of new territory for me personally in terms of short stories that I've read in the past. This book is very much looking at mythology and thinking about queer identity and the immigrant experience. What I really like about this collection is that it is not afraid to dabble immensely in magical realism and thinking about myth making and how that is portrayed through the themes that I already mentioned. And the book is divided into three different sections: mothers, myths, and moths. And so this book is looking at this idea of parenthood, namely motherhood, also thinking about communal storytelling and lineage and what that looks like in the short story form, and sort of expanding the boundaries of what is real and what is not through myth and through the collective storytelling that is passed down through myth, and then also thinking about ghosts and grieving and how those all play throughout all these stories. But it's also structurally interesting in terms of her really focusing on those themes in those three sections throughout this book. There are so many images from this book and so much scene setting that will stay with me. This book is very much rooted in the body and bodily functions and thinking about what it means to occupy a body while also sort of expanding that idea through not being afraid to think about the body in more mythical ways or more abstract ways. And so overall, this book was incredibly challenging for me to read in terms of me not really being familiar with reading a lot of magical realism or myth in my life. And it was really fun to see sort of had the boundaries of short storytelling kind of be widened for me as a reader and seeing how far Kaiming Chang could sort of flex the story to hold all these different elements. And I think she's so deft at doing that in the short story form. So yeah, if you want some queer magical realism, poetic short stories, this is one for you. Next up, I read what I think is my favorite fiction book of the month. It's Post Traumatic by Chantal V. Johnson. This book is truly like everything I was looking for in a novel, given my interest this year in thinking about autofiction, thinking about the idea of a trauma plot as explored through Pearl Sagal's essay in The New Yorker, and thinking about, I guess, of like sad girl fiction. I've been thinking a lot about these trends in publishing and thinking about what it is, like the TikTok book talk of it all, of like the sad girl in fiction trends, and thinking about what is successful in that subgenre and when is it getting stale and like what is that all doing. And I feel like this book explores that in a really nuanced, interesting, engaging way. This book follows Vivian, who is a Black Latinx lawyer who represents or advocates for mentally ill patients at a New York City psychiatric hospital. So in representing these patients, she's thinking a lot about trauma and how that's processed through the mentally ill patients that she represents. But aside from that, on her own, Vivian is also battling with her own trauma from her childhood. And what I think this book does so well is that through kind of interspersing these different vignettes of Vivian's life and balancing it with her career, Chantal V. Johnson is really looking at this idea of how, as an adult, do we process trauma, but not doing it in a way that's derivative or has already been seen before in fiction. It's very much rooted in the present experience of dealing with trauma and not leaving it as a mystery or a question for the reader. The book doesn't really look at the exact trauma that Vivian faced when she was growing up. However, the book is looking at how is that playing out in the present for Vivian, and what does it mean to move consistently through your life while having this traumatic baggage hanging on you? And what does it mean to process it? And can you ever truly fully process that? Or is it something that you're constantly working with? These explorations of Vivian's are balanced with her friendship, which is at the core of this novel that I really loved and lends a lot of humor to the narrative, and how her friend is very understanding of Vivian and her idiosyncrasies and thinking about how she moves every single day with the anxiety that she has as a result of her identity and also given her traumatic history. Vivian also goes on dates and also thinks about her career and what she wants to do with her life. And I just loved throughout this book how at once conversational and very understanding Chantal V. Johnson is of the sort of stereotypes or common assumptions about what it means to live with trauma and how that's been explored in prior narratives, and really subverting all of those through this novel and just adding a lot of complexity with Vivian, who is very understanding of all of these things. How do you have a character who is completely understanding of all of the sort of narrative tropes or stereotypes and assumptions about the kind of person that she's expected to be? And how does Chantal V. Johnson explore Vivian through this book in a third-person framework to explore all those questions while still being understanding of those things while still having to deal with thinking about what it means to live with trauma. We also see how Vivian suffers from disordered eating and how she sort of seeks control through her eating habits. And she also has many scenes with her family and how she sort of holds resentment towards that family and the decisions that she makes in regards to continuing or not those relationships and how it all kind of reaches ahead by the end of this novel. And so, yeah, this book is so complex, so full of interesting ideas and just really new territory for this idea of the trauma plot that was so refreshing to read after thinking about it so much this year. So I highly recommend this book. It is incredible. Please read it. Next up, I read Bliss Montage by Ling Ma. This is a new short story collection coming out in September this year. And I actually have not read Severance by her, but I suspect it's a book that I'm really going to like. But this is a collection of 8 short stories that are looking at a lot of similar themes throughout them, but also they each stand alone, I would say. The best way I can talk about this collection, I think, in total is it sort of feels like the Twilight Zone, I want to say, in terms of Ling Ma playing with certain surrealist elements in each story to explore a more broad theme, whether it be motherhood, friendship, domestic violence. She explores really harrowing subjects throughout this collection. And the number one through line that I saw in this collection was thinking about domestic violence and how Ling Ma looks at it in this collection. But overall, I think if you like surrealist and sort of weird and out there short stories that are playing with this idea of reality and subverting it just a little bit to sort of explore greater themes, I think this will be a collection for you. And just to give you a sampling of what these stories are about, first story is about a woman who lives in a house with all of her ex-boyfriends. And the reveal in that story, so good. I think it's my favorite story in the collection. It's the first one, called Los Angeles. In another one, a toxic friendship grows up around a drug that makes you invisible. Love that story too. It was really interesting seeing how she plays with the invisibility between this friendship and that story. So weird and really, really smart. And the ending, also incredible. And finally, an ancient ritual might heal you of anything if you bury yourself alive. Also a wild one. And I think Ling Ma plays a lot with surprise and uses certain reveals in her stories that I think is really rewarding and well-earned in the short story form. So if you're looking for some weird, slightly spooky, little out there short stories, it's a slim little collection that's coming out in September, I recommend it. Next up, I have another fiction book that I really loved. It's Sirens and Muses by Antonia Angris. And I feel like I've talked about this book a couple times on my channel this month already, so I'll keep it sort of brief. But essentially, this book follows 4 people that are at this art college. And 3 of them are students. One of them is a visiting professor. And we see how their lives come together, and seeing how the 3 students sort of fall in and out of love with each other in a quite messy love triangle, but also thinking about the professor and thinking about art and political ambition and thinking about those 2 things as this book is set around the Occupy movement of 2011 and thinking about how one pursues a career in art and the sort of downfalls of that pursuit or challenges of it, and also thinking about how art as a political practice can make things even more messy. But I really loved Antonia Angris's depiction of ambition and love and how personal ambition and desire and politics, how they're all sort of one thing in this book, one entity that is moving all these characters along. And I think from just a pure character perspective, all these characters stand out so well in my mind. It was really fun reading a very character-focused, plot-driven novel about art and politics and ambition. Just kind of watching the juicy, gossipy drama of it all play out throughout this book is really fun. Yeah, so I highly recommend this book. I am actually interviewing Antonia this week, so it'll be up next week. And I'm very excited to chat with her about this book. Next up, I reread Latvona by Otessa Moshfegh. Not going to go into it. I have an individual book review. And then I also had a book club this month with Kieran Reeder. And that was a really fun conversation. And so I'll link that below as well. But you know, I love Moshfegh. I had to reread it for the book club. And it was a great experience. So I loved it. Next up, I have Small Things Like These by Claire Keegan. I am embarking on reading maybe all, maybe not, of the Booker long list. And this is the smallest one. So I picked this one up first. And I have an individual book review of this one up. So I'll keep it sort of brief. But this is essentially a engaging, but I think overall quite twee novella about a guy named Bill Furlong, who is a coal merchant in Ireland in the 1980s. And this book follows him as he realizes that something is going on at the local convent, and he has the opportunity to make a decision that can help someone. And so the book is really thinking about this moral of, when do we set ourselves aside to help someone else? And so this book has this sort of classic Christmassy feel to it, but I think this book interestingly explores the historical context of the Magdalen Laundries in Ireland in the 1980s and using it in this framework to really tell an effective story in quite a small page count. So I think overall, I would recommend this book if you're looking for something short and sweet to read. But I will say overall, this is just not really for me as a reader. And I think the sort of sentiment of it ended up feeling quite twee by the end of it for me, but I do recognize that it's quite effective in terms of its brevity and what she's trying to do with the historical context. So that's that one. Next up, I have my favorite book of the month, I think, and it's nonfiction, Who Am I? But this book is A Horse at Night, On Writing by Amina Kane. This book, y'all, I can't even, like, I'm not even going to begin to be able to summarize why I love this book so much. I'm not even a writer, but this book is very much for me in terms of me, in terms of my love of literary criticism and reading about writing and books themselves. And this book is a very brief collection of sort of vignettes and Amina Kane's reflections on writing and fiction and reading and how living your life and reading fiction and crafting it are sort of one and the same for her as a reader and a writer. And the sort of like meditative and deeply reflective aspects of this book I have related to so much in terms of myself being a sort of like self-proclaimed overthinker and just thinking about how, like, through the things that I create, what am I drawn to and why am I drawn to certain books and what they're doing through the form. It's been something I've been thinking a lot about lately. I love how Amina Kane is able to reflect how the mundane in life is what fascinates her so much and how she replicates that through her fiction. She says in this book that she's not really as preoccupied with plot or suspense and tension. She's really looking at how can you reflect the reality of our existence through the fictional form. And another writer that she talks about in this book that is also thinking about these questions in her literary criticism is Elena Ferrante. I read her book In the Margins earlier this year, and a lot of similar questions sort of come up in terms of what is the art of fiction doing in terms of replicating our reality. Amina Kane, through this book, is thinking about the sort of mundane aspects of living and how she writes through them in the books that she thinks explore those mundane aspects really well. So she thinks about subjects such as female friendship, light and dark, and how the way light and dark fall in a room, how can you reflect that through a sentence, and how can you give the reader a heightened sense of what that means to be in a room that has that particular setting, and thinking about fiction as a form of being able to give a heightened sense of reality to a reader. And so for me, as only a reader, I don't really write myself. It was really interesting thinking about how I think about certain books and the ways in which I seek out certain things in my fiction and thinking about why I do that. Overall, I cannot recommend this book enough. The pure, like, beauty and just revelatory nature of her writing and her sharp sentences, I was floored the entire time I was reading it, and I annotated the hell out of this book. I don't often annotate, but it just spoke to me so deeply that I had to take my time with it. It took me like a week to read this book. It's very slim, but I recommend just like reading this maybe at night with a cup of tea and just really being in a very ponderous, reflective mood. And I think that's the best way to read this book. I love it so much. It's a new favorite of mine. Please read it. It's so good. Next up, I read another Booker longlisted book. It's The Colony by Audrey McGee. I'm planning to do a separate solo review of this one, so I'm going to keep this one short. But essentially, we follow an English painter and a French linguist who go to this island off the coast of Ireland. And this is set in 1979, and we see the painter and the linguist in their own pursuits. The painter is trying to make a great work of art, and the linguist is trying to document the perpetual degradation of Gaelic language on this island and talking to the people who are still speaking in Irish, what it means to preserve the original language. We also meet a family that lives on this island who they're staying with, and we see through various vignettes that are spliced through this book a lot of the violence that is going on amidst the troubles in Ireland during this time. And so this book is really thinking about colonization and these ideas of personal ambition and the relationships that we have to each other through family and language and culture in a really interesting and engaging way. And I think Audrey McGee uses a really interesting stylistic choice throughout this book in terms of her blending the sort of stream of consciousness style with dialogue that has no quotations. And so all of it sort of feels like it blends together in a very lyrical way, which is really interesting. She jumps tenses throughout the book. In the middle of a sentence, she'll switch tenses, which is really interesting, and dive into the minds of certain characters. And I think from a character perspective and a setting perspective, this book is really engaging on that front. But I'll have full thoughts to come. I think this one will be shortlisted for the Booker, but I'm kind of confused as to why people are so like obsessed with this book from what I've seen. But I do think it's strong, just not like a personal favorite of mine by any means. And then finally, I read another heavy hitter dark book. It is Dogs of Summer by Andrea Abreu. I think that's how you say her name, translated by Julia Sanchez. This book comes out August 2nd, and this is a book that I think if you like Fernanda Melchor's writing, this is a must read. We follow these two 10-year-old girls that are living in Tenerife, Spain, and so they live near this volcano in Tenerife. Similar to The Colony, this book is very much rooted in setting, I would say. We follow these two 10-year-old girls who are best friends, but they have a very toxic relationship. The narrator is named Shit. We don't really learn her real name throughout this book, and her friend Isora, who she's fascinated with, and she has certain longings toward her friend that reveal themselves as you read more of the book. But this book is told in a bunch of very short vignettes in which we see different aspects of their friendship and how Shit grows up, not really understanding what's going on around her. And so Andrea Abro, she's really occupying this narrative mind of a 10-year-old. And so she uses misspellings and Shit. She doesn't really understand certain things around her. And you see how she processes those things. While this book is rooted in that youth, it also lends itself a very lyrical and poetic style through embodying this 10-year-old voice, which is really interesting. But I will say by the end of this book, it is so harrowing. It is very disturbing. This book is also deeply rooted in the body and the bodily functions. And thinking about this like prepubescent age of Shit and Isora and how the questions that they have about their bodies and the world around them is really portrayed in a quite visceral and stark way in this book. And this book is just immensely, immensely fucked up and dark. If you like a book that is looking at female friendship, how trauma is processed at an age while embodying a voice that is of that time, I think this is a really interesting book that is definitely for fans of Fernanda Melchor. If you sort of have the stomach, I think you'll like this a lot. So yeah, that was my July reading wrap up. I can't seem to form cohesive thoughts today. So hopefully editing, Jalen, I'm looking at you. I hope I did not mess with you too much. But anyways, I will catch you all in the next one. Bye.